Today we're going to be talking about a new album. This time we're now into 1974, and as you can see, each year for the last 3 years, 1973, early 1973, then solid into 1973, and then 1974. In the space of just about 3 years, we get three albums. First, Catch a Fire, and then Burning, and then of course this new album. Now, a lot has happened in the life of Bob Marley and the Wailers. One of the key developments that has occurred is that Bob Marley and the Wailers have split. They've decided to go their own ways. There's a lot of history behind this, interesting history behind this, and it ranges in you know, from something that was amicable and pretty straightforward to the suggestion that there were some tensions. I think it's fair to say that the truth is somewhere in the middle of it. I don't think the tensions were a disruption of friendships, but the tensions had to do with creative opportunities, I guess I would say. And what was clearly happening was that there was some pressure that was coming from Chris Blackwell to center the band around Bob Marley. The reason for this, it was quite clear. They made no secret of it that both Bonnie Wailer and Peter Tosh were not entirely trusting of Chris Blackwell. They understood him to be a white Jamaican from privilege, in a business in which the people who owned the capacity to produce the production really would extract from the artist anything that they could get, and therefore there was this period in which these artists were recognizing, first of all, the oppressive structure of Jamaican society, which is racially charged and racially complicated. But at the same time, they were watching the enactment of this situation in the ways in which the producers had some control over the artists. But even if there was no sort of real tension, it did exist, there was also the fact that Chris Blackwell clearly had in mind that the person that he could best get along with, the person that he felt he had a rapport with, would be a positive way of seeing it, but the person that he felt some kind of connection with was Bob Marley. I think he was comfortable with Bob Marley's work ethic, Bob Marley's enthusiasm, and Bob Marley's cool. Bob Marley was sexy. By that I mean, was an attractive kind of prospect. Chris Blackwell could see in Marley a kind of charisma and presence that would translate into wider society and so on. So that was one thing. He also recognized that Marley was a leader in the group. Marley had always been somebody who would drive production. He was writing most of the songs for the records that they were making, and his songs were clearly the ones that they had focused in on, and they all seemed to gravitate around. And so Chris Blackwell began to give Marley attention, not only that, but to take Marley aside, to privilege Marley, to put Marley in positions when they went into producing the songs in terms of the mix, remix in the UK. It was Marley who went with him. So there was that factor. The other factor, of course, was Peter Tosh, of course, simply did not trust Chris Blackwell. This named him Chris Whitewell, of course, because he saw that they were reenacting the structure of an oppressive society. And I think Blackwell was afraid of Peter Tosh. I don't think there's any question about that. Finally, there's Bonnie Wailer. Bonnie Wailer was in a very interesting position, somebody who was producing his own songs, clearly a talented and incredibly gifted artist. But Bonnie Wailer at that point had lost interest in touring. He really didn't want to tour. He didn't enjoy touring. He especially didn't enjoy touring in the Northern Hemisphere because of the cold, because of the accommodations that we made. These guys were traveling not as superstars with all the trappings of superstardom, but they were traveling in tough touring environments. They were not staying in grand hotels. They were staying in houses when they toured London. They had to find their own food. They had to find, you know, all the things that sort of we think of, you know, superstars getting. They were not necessarily getting. And Bonnie Wailer was not entirely sure that that he was getting a fair shake in that arrangement. So at some point, Bonnie Wailer, while they were on tour in the UK, abandoned. He just gave up. He said he's no longer doing it. He returns to Jamaica, and they have to find somebody to replace Bonnie Wailer for the rest of the tour. One of their mentors, an artist who was their mentor, Bonnie Wailer famously said, "I will not fly in no Iron Bird." Now, what happens immediately after that probably is the greatest evidence of what was happening. Both Bonnie Wailer and Peter Tosh go on to produce two amazing albums. Bob Marley produces Natty Dread, and they all play on each other's albums. They're all supporting each other's albums. So it is clear that the artistic drive was just as important, if not more important, to why the group eventually broke up. So then we have Bob Marley's first release after the breakup. A couple of things start to happen at that time. Bob Marley working with the band now he has control of the band, which is Carlton Barrett, Family Man Barrett, drum and bass brothers. And then Tyrone Downey, and a cadre of musicians that would become this incredible crack band, one of the best bands in the world through experience, through confidence, and through authority. And they became very good, very tight, very quickly because they rehearsed like hell. And Bob Marley's work ethic was stupid, insane work ethic. What they add to that unit is this group called the I3. The I3 would be Judy Mort, Marcia Griffiths, and of course Bob Marley's wife, Rita Marley. And we hear them in full energy and full drive in Natty Dread. Natty Dread, on the album, A Rasta Man with His Locks. Natty Dread refers to the dreadlocks. Natty Dread is the dreadlocks that the Rastas wear. And the dreadlocks are a sacramental thing. Rastas grew their hair long in keeping with the you know, when Samson had made a vow to God and to follow God and to stay pure under God, one major part of his vow was, of course, not to cut his hair, not to have any razor go through his hair. In a sense, the Rastas embrace that idea, the idea of a physical sacrifice. Now, the locks, of course, have had a long history with spirituality, whether it's the sadhus in India, whether it is the Mau Mau fighters in East Africa, fighting against the British, and throughout the world. The idea of unkempt hair, that is not cutting the hair, letting the hair grow, and the wildness of it, the aggression of it, is a common practice, or it's an understood practice, and it certainly becomes one of the key tenets of Rastafarianism. Now, as in one of the great songs, you don't have to dread to be Rasta, you don't have to have locks to be a Rasta. This is true. Locks were a public sign of one's commitment to Rastafarianism, but you could be a Rasta without wearing locks. However, in the idiom of Rasta, the bald head represented those who were not believers. So the term bald head would come to mean those who are not believers. So this is the album, Natty Dread. And I think one of the things we can do is just, you know, sort of talk about each of these songs. Two sides, as again, we have to always talk about it in that way. Lively Up Yourself is number one on that side. No Woman, No Cry, number two. Then Belly Full, But We Hungry, number three. And the fourth song on that side, Rebel Music, otherwise called 3 O'Clock Roadblock. Now, there are a number of things that are very interesting about that album, by the way. Now, I should go back a little bit and say that one of the things that Marley had done prior to signing with Island Records was that he had already signed a writer's contract with Cayman Music, a North American and American outfit. And Marley was writing songs for people like Johnny Nash and for other artists, and that was a contractual arrangement. Well, the problem, of course, was that they were not relinquishing that arrangement. So when Bob Marley was starting to write new songs, the Cayman Music felt that they had a right to those songs, and Marley didn't want to be tied down by that contractual arrangement. So you can see that all the songs in Burning and Catch a Fire were not necessarily new songs. They were songs that already existed. So Marley was just using songs that existed, and they were not therefore infringing on the contractual arrangement with Cayman Music. But by the time he gets to Natty Dread, he's really, really generating new songs. So something interesting starts to happen. It happens here in Natty Dread, and it also happens in Rastaman Vibration. Once you look at the list of credits, writer's credits, you see a name like Vincent Ford, Leon Coggill, Carlton Barrett, Aston Barrett. These are the drum and bass musicians. Hugh Peart is also given a credit. This is for Rebel Music. Rita Marley is given a credit. And she apparently co-wrote So Jesse, the song So Jesse, with a man called Willie Francisco. Alan Skin Cole, who is not a musician by any stretch of the imagination. Alan Skin Cole was one of the greatest soccer players Jamaica had ever produced. And he was a very close friend of Bob Marley. They used to play soccer together. Skin Cole gets a credit for the title song Natty Dread with Rita Marley. So, of course, something fishy is going on there. Now, I should say that the end of this story is fairly recent. You know, about 10 years ago, there was a big, maybe a little longer than that, but there was a big, long after Bob Marley died, there was a, Cayman Music were suing the Marley estate for residual rights on those songs, saying that Marley had written the songs himself, but had given credit to a fraudulent activity by falsely crediting people who didn't write the songs. The court saw found in Marley's favor. And so even me saying that it's clear that Marley was handing over the copyrights to these people as a way of circumventing the problems of ceding the profits to Cayman Music and ceding the rights to Cayman Music. And it worked. It worked, quite simply. But there's a touching moment in that idea. Vincent Ford is credited for No Woman, No Cry, probably the most popular song on that album, and probably one of Bob Marley's most popular, most successful songs. Vincent Ford was a young man, well, he was a young man at the time, who would eventually suffer from diabetes, would be an amputee, who Marley always credited for looking after him and his family when things were really hard in the ghetto. Vincent Ford fed them, and he's referred to as Tata, and Marley actually sings about Tata in a number of his songs. So Marley crediting Vincent Ford was not just casual. He got some of the residual. I think he may have gotten the residual credits on No Woman No Cry. So in a sense, Marley was not just simply circumventing the issue, but he was actually trying to support people. And these people have their names on it. And on Marley's death, they own the copyrights on these songs. And the rights on these songs are not a joke. I don't think, if you know anything about the music business, the rights for these songs, every time a song is played, radio stations, Spotify, any of them would have to pay the artist some money. So that's good money that goes on for a long time. So there's an interesting phenomenon that's there. So here we go. We've got the album that begins with Lively Up Yourself. The lyric is Lively Up Yourself and Don't Be a Drag. Don't be no drag. Lively Up Yourself. Because reggae is another bag. You rock so like you never did before. You dip so, and you dip through my door. You come so, like I do adore. You skank so, come alive today. Lively up yourself, and don't say no. Lively up yourself, because I say so. More than the lyric, of course, is the admonition. This is the beginning of the album. This is the first thing you hear. Lively up yourself, meaning get up, meaning bring up yourself. Reggae is another bag, and it's one of those songs that declares reggae to be the voice of liberation. The livening up yourself is it. And of course, it's a dance song. He says, you rock so, which is the way you dance reggae. You dip so, dip through my door. You come so, and you skank. Skanking is also a reggae thing. So it's a dance tune. It's not a dance tune with sort of choreographed steps, but it's a song that has this kind of lively energy, this kind of drive that made it popular. And he says, "What you got that I don't want?" I'm wondering why you're acting so. I say you rock so. You dip so, you come so, you scan so, you scan so. The next song is No Woman No Cry. And it's an interesting version of No Woman No Cry, because now No Woman No Cry in this version is it's a faster tune. And it's quite different from the one that sort of really blew up. And when it blew up because of a live version of No Woman No Cry. And it'd be interesting to compare the two of them. I'm going to spend some time just looking at the lyrics of No Woman No Cry, but I want you to get a feel of the contrasting versions of it. This version is the version that appears on the album, Natty Dread, and then I'll play you the live version. No Woman No Cry has been covered by so many artists, and quite successfully by so many artists. So it'll be interesting to just listen to the versions of the song. So this is the version that appears on Natty Dread, right? Seems slow, but it's not. Lots of organ feel there. No woman no cry. No woman no cry. No woman no cry. No woman no cry. Cause I remember when we used to sit. And so that's the studio version, and it has a kind of poppy kind of bounce to it. Lovely organ work, but of course it's up there. So here is now the live version, and this live version is a very important version because it was a live version recorded in the Elysium Stadium in London, and being performed to an immigrant audience, right? An audience that were Jamaicans living in England at the time. You may not hear it as clearly in this version, in this mix, sort of, but it was when it was remixed by the Marley's children, they raised the voice, the noise of the audience, so that you could hear how they sang with Bob Marley. By this time, Marley's into superstardom, and this is how he decides to play No Woman No Cry, same song. There's the crowd, live. Much slower. Beautiful, beautiful. And then, of course, you can hear the i3s at Wailers. Incredible organ work. Marley. Incredibly beautiful, and it's wonderful to hear the audience singing along. The intimacy of that moment. But what is this song, No Woman, No Cry? I remember once giving a talk. I was teaching this class many years ago. I've taught this class for many years. And I asked some of the students what it does mean, and one student says, well, it means that if you have a woman, if you don't have a woman, then you won't cry. And it does sound logical. No woman, you don't cry. No woman, no cry. But it's a misreading, misunderstanding of the Jamaican dialect. Marley is saying, Marley is commanding, appealing, pleading to his woman. No woman, don't cry. No woman, don't cry, because. So here we have this moment where it's clear that this woman is crying. And we have this moment where an intimacy is going to take place, a love song, but a different kind of love song. And this is Marley's contribution to the love songs of all times. Because in no point does he say, I love you. There's no expression of affection, but there's the action of affection. And here is the lyric. Because I remember when we used to sit in a government yard in Trench Town. Government yards were projects, essentially, built by the government for poor people to dwell in the ghettos of Jamaica. These were very roughly put together houses. They were not high buildings. They were really sort of bungalows. In some instances, they had no running water inside the homes. They had to go to pipes that were put outside for water. Cooking was done outside. It's a government yard. And it's a yard where everybody says, but he says, I remember when we used to sit in a government yard in Trench Town, observing the hypocrites as they would mingle with the good people we meet. Good friends we had, and good friends we've lost along the way. In this great future, you can't forget your past, so dry your tears, I say. Good friends we've had, and good friends we've lost. Lost because of death, violence, sickness. death because of migration. Migration was such a big factor and continues to be such a big factor in places like Jamaica, where mothers would leave and fathers would leave to go abroad, to England, to America, to Florida, to New York, to Canada, to Panama, to make a living, leaving the children to be raised by other family members, grandparents, and so on. Whole generation, generations and generations of people who might call them forward to these places or may never do that. Lost by death, losses, good friends we had and good friends we've lost, and lost because friendships get broken. Observing the hypocrites mingling with the good people. So this is a world in which good people and hypocrites are walking hand in hand. We have to know who is who. So dry your tears, I say. No woman, no cry. No woman, no cry. Second verse. I remember when we used to sit in a government yard in Trenchtown, and then Georgie would make the fire as it was logwood burning through the night. The fire burning is a ritual for not as much for warmth, but for cooking. And logwood was a cheap wood, but a durable wood, a wood that would ensure a long-term burn. And it was available throughout. Boy, they would go and scavenge for firewood. This is in Kingston. But this specificity of Marley's lyric, logwood burning through the night, this happens nowhere else. And yet Marley is taking the local, the life that he's living. He's looked out of the window and he's created this incredible love song out of it. Georgie would make the fire as it was logwood burning through the night. Then we will cook cornmeal porridge, of which I'll share with you. You see, my feet is my only carriage, so I've got to push on through. First of all, the rhyming of porridge and carriage is genius. Any artist, any poet would envy that because it's brilliant. But look at what Marley does. He says, then we will cook cornmeal porridge. Cornmeal porridge is the cheapest, least expensive food that you could get for poor people to eat. But it's cooked with love and with tenderness. This is a love song that is not full of bling. It's not full of I will give you everything. It's love that is intimate and in the moment. It's almost the kind of love that we occasionally see sung about in country songs. But this is not a country story. This is a Jamaican story. Then we will cook cornmeal porridge, of which I'll share with you. You see, my feet is my only carriage. So double down on a man who is not able to afford a car or a bicycle. But she deserves a carriage. So my feet is my only carriage. It's also a very sophisticated use of carriage, because it's, of course, in the original meaning of carriage, the thing that carries us around. So my feet is my only carriage. So I've got to push on through. But while I'm gone, everything's going to be all right. Everything's going to be all right. No woman, no cry. No woman, no cry. A beautiful, beautiful, beautiful lyric. And then the idea of everything is going to be all right is the hope. It's the cry. Yet he's saying, for these reasons, for the reasons that we've seen life, we've lived life, we've experienced life, and we've experienced the pain and the hardship, we've gone through all of this together, don't cry. Because we will make this work. Everything's going to be all right. Everything's going to be all right. I think it's worth just listening to that, to the way that ends in this beautiful, beautiful version. My little sister, don't shed no tears. And here, just one of the great solos. Great solo. I remember. For anybody who wants to understand the power of reggae music, I think that's a classic moment, a really important moment. The collective sense, and yet the sense of hope, possibility, and the sense of faith in the midst of that. Everything's going to be all right. I think Bob Marley was truly at his greatest moment in performance, anyway, on that. But we must leave No Woman No Cry. Then we have two more songs on this side of the album, which we look at. Them Belly Full But We Hungry. And Them Belly Full But We Hungry is now straight up political, right? Them Belly Full But We Hungry, a hungry man is an angry man. Rain or fall, even though it's raining, but a dirty tough, dirty is the earth, the dirt, dirty tough. A pot, a cook, but the food, not enough. So these are all these aphorisms, these proverbial aphorisms, and they're setting up a story. They're belly full, but we are hungry. So they, them, the rich, and these thems will come back again and again in Marley's lyrics. Them belly full, but we hungry. A hungry man is an angry man. In a, later on in the song, he says, a hungry mob is an angry mob. Rain or fall, even though it's raining, the ground is tough. Even though the pot is cooking, there's no food in it. And he would turn that into Rasta talk, a yata yoke, but the yod not enough. It's not enough. We're gonna dance to the music. Dance. Now, this seems like an absurdly irresponsible response to this hardship. But what Marley's beginning to remind us is that the dance to jam music is a dance of resistance, is a dance of resilience, it's a dance of survival. The verse, cost of living gets so high, rich and poor, they start to cry. Now the weak must get strong, they say, oh, what a tribulation. Them belly full, but we hungry. A hungry mob is an angry mob. Rain or fall, but the dirty tough. Pot of cook, but the food not enough. We're gonna chuck to the music. And of course, the word chuck is a more violent act. So we're not dancing, but now we are chucking. And that slow movement from just a dance to something that is dangerous, that is rebellious. I don't know if you've seen any stories about the apartheid movement and the anti-apartheid movement. One of the characteristics of that movement was people doing the toy toy dance. The toy toy dance is a dance of resistance. it's a very powerful dance, because when the police, the apartheid police, saw it, they trembled and were thoroughly afraid. And of course, it becomes, Marley's replicating that idea in this, you know, quite remarkable and quite powerful song. Them belly full, but we're hungry. A hungry mob is an angry man. I think that the story that he tells when he says cost of living gets so high, rich and poor, they start to cry. Now the weak must get strong, they say. Oh, what a tribulation. It's a quite important and quite powerful articulation of what the struggle is and what the battle is in this. So let's just listen to a little bit of this song. Forget your sorrows and dance, and then forget your sickness.
Forget your sickness
and dance. Forget your weakness.
Forget your weakness
and dance. Verse.
Cost of living gets so high.
Rich and poor, they start to cry. Now the weak must get strong, they say. Oh, what a tribulation.
Them
belly full, but we hungry.
Hungry mob is a hungry mob.
There we go.
Rain or fall, but a dirty top.
So for mob,
a pot of yuck, but you don't know. We're gonna chuck to jam music. Chucking.
That's the transformation.
Hey, we're chucking to jam music. We're chucking.
I mean, you know, this is fantastic, the way that Marley takes us from this moment where we are dancing to the music. Forget your weakness, forget your sorrow, forget your sickness, and dance. And then slowly we begin to understand what a dance is, right? Because they will say, oh, what a tribulation. But I love the way that Marley stopped paying attention. He stopped being worried about what people understand. Ayata yuk, meaning that he's speaking now in his own dialect, and you will just have to follow him. And for many who didn't understand what Marley was saying, it became a kind of coding, and so you tried to pick up what you could from it. So Them Belly Full But We Hungry is such a clear statement about the haves and the have-nots. And Marley puts himself on the side of the have-nots, and he's going to sing for the have-nots. And Marley was very clear about it. I think you've seen it in the documentary when Marley says very explicitly, he says, look, if I can't do anything for my people, then I don't want any riches. I don't want anything, because that's my purpose on this earth. I think this is true about Marley. Marley never had ostentatious wealth. He was successful, but he you know, the true wealth of Marley comes after his death. Marley was supporting, the estimate is about 300 families for the latter part of his life, with food and clothing and everything like that. That was what he did. So Marley was not splurging with money in any incredible way. So that's Dembele Full. And then finally on that side, we have Rebel Music. And in Rebel Music, we get this other sort of narrative. And here we're talking about the struggle with police, the police as the uniforms of brutality that we mentioned on Burning. There's a wailing sound that begins in our Rebel Music. Or why can't we roam this open country? Why can't we be what we want to be? We want to be free. 3 o'clock in the road. Roadblock, curfew, and I've got to throw away my little herb stock. So there's the story. Why can't we roam this open country? The open country is Jamaica. Why can't we be what we want to be? And what do we want to be? We want to be free. And free goes into 3 o'clock. 3 o'clock. Roadblock. And then the complaint is, I've got to throw away my herb. The little herb stop that he has to throw it away because herb is illegal. And he's in danger of being beaten or arrested by the police. And then the chorus is, Rebel Music. This is Rebel Music, right? This is Rebel Music. Let's just hear the beginning of that. Good stuff. This is good stuff. Why can't we roam this open country? Going into the next verse, and he says, of course, check, he's daring the police. He says, take my soul and suss me out, meaning search my soul, and then check my life. If I'm in doubt, if there's any doubt about me. He says, I'm telling you, 3 o'clock. Roadblock. And then he says, cop. Hey, Mr. Cop. I've got no. Hey. Hey, Mr. Cop. What'd you say now there? I've got no birth certificate on me. Meaning, I do not have the tools of this oppressive system to prove myself. Marley goes on throughout this song to talk about it's in the rain, 3 o'clock in the rain, roadblock. That interrogation moment, he says, check my life and suss me out. Check my soul and suss me out. Check my life if I'm in doubt. 3 o'clock in the rain, roadblock, curfew. And then, hey cops, I got no birth certificate on me. But he does that wonderful way of inverting the phrase from birth certificate to birth certificate, which is a kind of Jamaicanism and a play on it. But it's also a finger pointed in the eye of the rebellious, of the oppressive, the police of Babylon. So, explicit rebel music. Lively up yourself and don't be a drag. Them bellyful, but we hungry. This is rebel music. This is rebel music. Marley's clearly now positioned himself as countercultural and a person who is creating a resistance to structures in society. And that's how the first half of that album, the first side of that album, ends. And it's quite a powerful one. Each of these songs are hugely successful and very popular and do well. This album actually does well. It's certified gold as well, which means in the UK it sold over 100,000 copies, which is a lot of copies, certainly at that time. But the other thing that we can say about it is that in the Rolling Stone poll, it ranked about 131. Of the 131st of the greatest albums ever produced, which is nothing to sniff at. Of course, there are some albums by the Exodus falls quite below that. By that, at a higher number, Exodus, named by the BBC as the album of the century. In 2000, it was named the album of the century, for instance. Time magazine named it the album of the century as well. So, you know, Marley is in that territory. Rebel music, 3 o'clock, roadblock. I think I'll end this half of our talk there. And then in the next lecture, we'll talk about the second half. And the second half has the song, So Jesse, very important song, Natty Dread, the title song, Bend Down Low, is a sweet lyric, Talking Blues, which is really important song that will allow us to see some of the things that Marley is doing. And then, of course, it ends with Revolution, which it this is in the first recording. Revolution is Marley speaking in the language of the 1970s in ways that are very telling and provocative, especially if you understand the context of Jamaica. So, and of course, Marley's life. We must always remember that Marley was the victim of an assassination attempt and was shot but survived the assassination. We'll stop there.